our terrarium class. This is, I'm Chris Stecker, the horticulture technician and venture garden program coordinator for Cooperative Extension here in Alamance County. And I'd like to welcome Liz Riley, who is the director of horticulture at ACC. And she's going to teach us how to make a terrarium while we make our own.
Yep.
All right, thanks, Chris.
Good morning, everyone. How are you? Thank you. You guys all good today?
Yes.
It's Thursday.
Yes.
Look, I love his energy. That's awesome. Yes, I need some of that. All right. So today I'm here. I have a slight hidden passion of making terrariums, but my secret's out because I'm here talking to you guys today. And I do a few other workshops throughout the year as well, just talking to people about terrariums. A lot of garden centers will reach out asking for activities that they can do to bring people in. And what better way than to do an activity where the participants actually get to go home with something already created with plants. So I've been at ACC now for a little over a year, and I'm the department head and I teach a bunch of different classes. So you'll hear some of my plant nerdiness come out when we start talking about the substrate and the drainage and stuff like that. So to get started, we are going to be making our own closed system terrarium. So there are two, when you look up and you're interested in terrariums, when you start to look that up, there are two types of terrariums. There is a closed system terrarium, which is what we're going to be making, and there is an open system terrarium. If you have an open system, what do you think that means? Exactly, right? It's pretty self-explanatory. There is no top on it. And when you start getting into the open system type of terrarium, your plant selection completely changes, your substrates change, everything is a different dynamic. So for today's class, we're really only going to be talking about closed system terrariums, which, to be honest, those are my favorite, right? You kind of create this little environment. It should be, for the most part, self-sustaining. And so we're going to focus on closed terrariums. And the first thing that you have to make a closed terrarium is sitting on your table in front of you. You've got to have some type of container to put it in. The purpose of creating a terrarium, it creates this really nice environment where plants love to grow. And so you want something that has a good, tight suction on it when you close it. I've used some jars before where there wasn't a very firm suction or it didn't close very tightly, and the water escapes. And if you're not paying super close attention to it and you go back a couple weeks later, your plants may be dried out. And so the fact that we can tighten these down is really helpful. You never want to tighten them too much because sometimes you do have to get into them, so just hand tight is good. I will tell you a little trick I learned. So I bought this really, these are cookie jars. So like I go to Target or Dollar Tree or Walmart, anywhere, and I just go to the cookie jar section to find closed glass jars. And so a little trick I learned, I found this really cool cookie jar that had this really pretty wooden top on it. And I made it, one of my friends was graduating, so I made the terrarium for her as a gift. Does anybody know what happens to wood when it gets wet? It expands. So this gorgeous lid was busting open literally at the seams. And I was like, well, didn't really think that would happen. But all I did was I got a piece of saran wrap and a rubber band, and I made another lid for it, put the saran wrap on it, put the rubber band, and then put the lid, which once it was dried out, went back to how it was supposed to be, put that on top. And that solved that problem really fast. So if you have a jar that's maybe not getting the best suction that you want, you know you're losing moisture, saran wrap, the clear kind, people will never know it's there. It hides really nicely. And so that kind of is just a little bit about where I find my jars, making sure that you've got a really nice jar that will shut tightly. And then for your jars, also, the size is important. You can do, I've seen people making terrariums lately in like little tiny light bulbs. I don't know how they do that without breaking them. I'm too clumsy. But, you know, you can make a terrarium as small as you want. Even the clear Christmas ornaments that you can buy at like Michael's or Hobby Lobby or places like that. Those, I made people Christmas ornament terrariums one year to put on their tree. Now, the top is not sealed shut very well, so they didn't last much longer than Christmas, but just the thought that they got to hang this little living ornament on a tree, they were really excited about. And so that was, you know, be creative. Think outside the box. Somebody brought in a cake dish today. I love that. I've always wanted to make a terrarium like that, so I'm interested to see how yours turns out, so I think that's going to be great.
Me too.
I've also seen terrariums as big as fish tanks, right? What is a fish tank, essentially? Some people use them as terrariums for their reptile pets and also fish. And they put aquatic plants in there. So people do make giant terrariums out of fish tanks. You know, anything that really is a clear glass is going to be your best bet. You can do plastic, like the Christmas ornaments. Those are obviously plastic. But it doesn't do quite as well because the water doesn't move on the plastic as well as it does when it's condensating. It can roll down easier on the glass. The glass sometimes is a little more clear. It's more sturdy. So plastic will work, but glass is your best bet. And then the last thing about a jar. So we know that we need it to shut tightly, right? That's a given. But if it doesn't, we know a secret now of how to fix that. We know that we can really use any size of a glass jar that we want to. It can be as little or as big as you would like. But also think about the neck opening. These are my favorite jars to use because my entire hand can fit down in here. I don't need anything awkward to go down in there and have to push the plants in. It's very easy. Your hand can go in. The plants can go in. If you have to go in and maintain it, you can really just do that yourself. I will say, you know, think creatively and pick a jar, and if it doesn't have a large neck, there are tools that you can use. And I apologize, I do not know the name of it, but it is essentially what you use if you drop a ring down a sink. It's this little claw thing that's about this long. You can buy it at Lowe's. It moves. You can use the little claw if you have a narrow opening to put the plants down, and it can work with you because it bends the plant. And I used to know the name of it, and it just left me. But again, it's about this long, and it's just found in the plumbing aisle at Lowe's. Its purpose is to go down a sink drain. So if it can go down a sink drain and grab a ring or an earring, it can go down in a terrarium and help you get that soil packed out and also get the plants in. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
Could you use a pale green glass, or do any colors work?
That's a good question, and unfortunately, I don't know the answer to that. The only problem with having a colored glass is you're already getting a little bit lower light because you're in a jar, and you can't sit these in direct sun, so you have to find somewhere that's bright enough for them. So I would try it, though. I do that all the time. I have lots of plants that I walk by, and I'm like, I don't know if this would work as a terrarium plant or not, so I take it home and test it out. So I would just try. I would give it a test out. For example, one of the terrarium plants that I had in this lovely jar that I'd had for years, and then my dog knocked it off the shelf and broke it. But it was a sundew. So a sundew is a carnivorous plant, but it was a really tiny one that somebody had given me. And I was like, well, they like it human. I don't know how they would do it here. And I put it in there, and it loved it because it's low nutrients, right, which is its typical habitat. And so just thinking outside the box, yes, a flexible grabber. That's easy enough. A flexible grabber. There we go. At Harbor Freight. You can give it at Harbor Freight as well. That is it. A flexible grabber. Yes. Now I need to remember that. Okay. So now we're going to move on. So you heard me mention that I give terrariums as gifts a lot. These make really fantastic gifts, especially something like this, because all you have to do once you got it planted is put the lid on it, tie a pretty bow on it, and give it to someone as a gift. And they can take it and sit it on their desk at work. If somebody's in the hospital, they can sit it there on their bedside table. It's just something that really cheers people up. And we all know how great plants are, but not everybody has come around to understand that yet. So what better way to share, look how awesome plants are. They're in this little jar. You can just sit them on your desk and they'll be happy. So definitely share these as gifts. My family really loves my gifts because they get lots of terrariums all the time. So, all right, so we've gone over the jar. So now we're going to talk about what we start to put into our terrarium. And so the way that the workshop will go is I'm going to walk through it, and I'm going to show you my process. And then once I'm done, you guys are going to be unleashed to make your own. And that way I can kind of walk through the room and work with you guys as you're doing it. Does that sound like a good idea? Will that work for everyone? Okay. So the first thing that you need to put into your terrarium is some type of rockery, okay? Some type of rockery. Now, if you go to a hobby store and they have those really tiny, or even a pet store, and they have those really tiny colored rocks that you use for fish tanks, those are too tiny, okay? You want to get something that's just a little bit bigger. So these rocks I have up here that you guys can check out, you can find these on the internet. Sometimes they're on Amazon. Sometimes you can find them at Dollar Tree. You can get a whole bag of them for $1. So hey, go at it. You can have a lot of rocks. So these, again, these are a little bit bigger. They kind of add a little bit of a decorative addition down in the bottom. But one thing that I really like, because you don't always have these on hand when you need them, and not every store, sometimes you just can't find them. How many of you know what Permatil is? You guys use Permatil? Okay, so Permatil is a product. We have a bag, two bags of it over here. It is a product that is used in the landscape to keep voles. So it's this little expanded slate product, and voles do not like to climb through it. It creeps them out. So they won't climb through it. People put it around their bulbs to keep the voles from going in and eating their bulbs. But this works great for the bottom of your terrarium. And you can get a giant, I've had that bag that's open, sitting on the table for probably 5 years now, making terrariums, and I'm halfway through it. So you can definitely get it. They're not so big that if you're working with a smaller age group and they happen to drop it in there, it's not gonna shatter it, whereas these are a little bigger, so they make a little bit more noise. So you can add your rocks into the bottom. Again, you can be really creative with your rocks, but you do want it to have some bulkier pieces in it, because that helps that. The purpose of the rocks is to create a drain. So as the water moves through the soil, there's a little reservoir hidden down there in the rocks that the plants can take the water back up. If it falls through the soil, they can take it back up still, and then it can move through the plant with transpiration. So again, it acts as a reservoir. Depending on how big your terrarium is will impact how big of a plant you can put in it. So if you've got, say, an aquarium that's a fish tank size, you can put really large plants in it. If you put big plants in there, what are those going to need more of? They're going to need more substrate in there, more soilless media. But for something this size, your rocks don't have to be too deep, but you do want to create enough so that you have plenty of room in there to create that drainage. So I'm actually going to get just a little bit more to add.
So do you use those rocks and the Permatil, or just one or the other?
One or the other, yeah. Okay. Yeah. This would probably, this may be enough for the bottom of that, but it may take a few more.
Yeah, that looks like just gravel that's down the roads.
Yeah, it does. It does look like that, but it is an expanded slate product that they actually process specifically. And it's processed in North Carolina specifically for.
So, did they have that at Lowe's and on Depot?
I think they have it at Lowe's. I got mine at an independent garden center, but I think they
should. Well, I had yesterday at Mevin Shrubbery.
Mevin Shrubbery, perfect. Okay, so I've got my rocks. I'm still gonna add just a little bit more. Got my rocks in, so there I can create my little reservoir for water. Looks good. It gives it a different color down there for aesthetic purposes. Then the next thing I'm going to talk about, I don't like to use, but if you decide to, that's fine. Sheet moss. Has anybody ever made a terrarium before and used sheet moss? Okay. Did it work for you? Did you see a benefit from it?
Yeah, it was a real long time ago.
Okay, so some terrarium, you can buy kits, right? You can go out, you can Google, you can buy terrarium kits, you can buy them, sometimes at Target they'll have them around Christmas time for gifts, and they always come with sheet moss, okay? The purpose of the sheet moss is to go on top of the rocks so that when you add your soil layer, the soil doesn't move into the rocks. Some of the sheet moss has not ever really been moss in its entire life. It's just synthetic, and it adds some of it has been real, which it could have some mold that starts to grow on it. You want to keep your terrarium as clean as possible to prevent, it's humid in there. There's water, it gets warm. It's a great place for stuff to start to grow, especially on something like sheet moss. And again, there's a lot of people that use it and love it. I have never had a problem. I mean, I don't shake my terrariums around, so my soil, when I put it in, it stays in place pretty well. So again, that's that. If you make another one and you decide you want to try it, go for it. I've used it. I didn't really see a benefit from it. I actually just prefer not to add that step in there. So the next thing that you do need to add, this one is really easy to forget, so everybody needs to make sure they do it. You need to add some type of activated charcoal, okay? Some type of activated charcoal. And what I have today, I have one that I bought at Durham Garden Center just because I happened to be in there. And it's just a product from Fertilome. And it's a little bit big of a particle, but that's okay. Even if you get some, and you guys will see it when you start working with it, even if you get some that's a finer, more powdery type particle, that's okay too. The only place I was able to find activated charcoal about 6 years ago when I started making these was a pet store, because they use those in the filters. So I still have the same bag of activated charcoal that's this kind of powder form that I bought at PetSmart 6 years ago, because you don't have to add a lot. The purpose of the activated charcoal is what? It's the same thing as in a fish tank. What does it do? It filters it. It keeps it clean. Not that we're necessarily going to smell our terrariums, but it does help keep that water nice and clean for the plants. It helps to keep stuff, weird stuff, from growing in there. So you really just add a small layer to it to help with that. Now, since this is the other powder that I've used covers a little bit better, so since this is a little bit chunkier, you can always just add a little bit extra. You're not going to get too much charcoal. The only downside to the charcoal is that it can be kind of pricey. And so you don't want to go too crazy with it, but you're not going to add too much of it, because we want that water to be nice and clean. All right, so I've got my activated charcoal layer added. Be careful. I was worried, since I'm on camera, I might rub my face. If I do, just don't tell me and we'll just go with it. Okay, potting media. So potting media is our next step. It took me a very, 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 very long time to find a potting media or substrate that I like. Because when you put this potting media in here and you close the lid on it, if there are fertilizers in it, what are they going to do?
Make it grow.
They're going to make it grow, but they may also vaporize. And if they happen to do that, they're going to burn your plants. So with a terrarium, you don't really want the plants to grow. Sounds kind of mean. But you want them to hang out in here, stay the same size. You may have to occasionally prune. But you don't want to put fertilizer in there and the plants start going crazy, because then it's just the system's going to fail. Do you know how hard it is to find a substrate that has no fertilizer in it?
Very hard.
None. I've only been able to find it one place. And so if you guys know it somewhere else, share with me. But Durham Garden Center carries this Fafford mix over here, and it's called Professional Potting Mix. And I'll bring it over here so they can
get
on
camera. They
have this at Nevin Shrubbery? Okay. Perfect. So this is just Fafford soil, potting soil, and it's for indoor and outdoor potted plants. But if you take a look on the back, which you all should be familiar with doing, to see if there's any fertilizer, there's no NPK or anything listed on the back. It is completely fertilizer free. This is what you have to do the terrariums, okay?
Other problem is finding soil without those water things in them too nowadays.
The hydrogel type stuff.
Yes.
I hadn't even thought of that.
Does anything have fertilizers? I don't think they
have the... They really only have like the compost. To my knowledge, I've only seen the compost and like the soil amendments. I haven't seen just straight potting soil from Daddy Pete's. But that is a good point. Thank you for bringing that up. If they have hydrogels or some kind of water holding, don't get those either. So this is just straight. This has peat, some perlite, and some vermiculite in it. Yes, ma'am.
When you're planting and you like to get down and dirty, mm-hmm. and really get in, let your nose smell everything you're doing.
Yeah.
When you pour something in, sometimes it makes dust.
Mm-hmm.
You should always wear a mask. Mm-hmm. I've been told I have emphysema, and it's been caused from breathing in dust, breathing in secondhand smoke. Anything that you continuously breathe in is doing damage to your lungs.
Wow. Okay, that's a good point. Having a mask on is like
Roundup has been called. They said, you know, if you use Roundup, just the residue of what you're smelling causes cancer.
Oh, wow.
So you be very careful about what you breathe in.
Okay, yep. So masks are never a bad thing. You can get a big pack of those at Lowe's for a reasonable price. Okay, so we're going to add in our soil now that we've gone over, our substrate. So you want to have enough substrate in the terrarium to support your plant growth. But you don't want it to be that when people look at your terrarium, all you're seeing is that potting soil. So what we have here is a very small layer right now of substrate. And I'm looking at it, and I can tell you right now, I'm going to need to add just a little bit more to get my plant roots to get down in there and be comfortable and be able to grow just a little bit. So far I've added about 1 cup. I think it's probably going to take about 1.5 cups of substrate.
That's more than a regular cup.
This Burger King cup. Yeah, we'll all be using the same cup. So for this purpose, it'll work. Okay, so you can see now I've got about an inch of soil. Now, it goes against every fiber of my being to tell you to compact substrate. I don't like it when people push it down. That messes with how much water and air it holds. But in this situation, once you put your plant in, they don't have that much substrate to grow into to support themselves. They're not being anchored very well. So actually pushing down on your soil just a little bit around those plant roots will help hold them up. Now, I don't mean, you know, don't be really manhandling it down in there, but just a little bit of firmness will help. Okay, so we've added our substrate. We know we don't want it with any pre-plant fertilizers. The next important thing is our plants, right? That's what's going to bring this alive and make it awesome. So for your plant selection, typically we're using tropicals or houseplants, all right? That's generally what we put in here. Moss, somebody brought in some moss. I love to harvest moss out of my yard and use it as just an extra little added bright green touch in there. That's fine. I will tell you that one time my husband went around and sprayed Roundup to kill weeds, and I didn't realize that the Roundup got on the moss, and then I put the moss into my terrarium, and then I closed it. Next day, everything was dead. I was like, yes, ma'am.
Is there an issue with bugs or anything if you use moss?
There could be an issue. So when you're getting moss out of its native habitat, it's best to clean it off as best as possible. Try to get as much of the soil, that native soil, off the bottom as you can without harming it, and then just kind of brush it off and just visually inspect it and take a look. There's always that added danger, but it's the same. I mean, I got these at Lowe's, so it's the same problem that you might have with bringing in any type of plant. So the plant material, the selection is really important because in this jar that we're now going to put a really airtight lid on and add water into, the humidity gets really, really high. So if plants cannot tolerate high humidity, they will rot. And it'll start to happen very quickly. If you do that, again, I totally encourage all of you guys to test out plants. If you see something unique and you're like, well, I don't know if that would work in a terrarium, try it out and see. But as soon as you start to see it rotting, go ahead, open it up, and just remove it, okay? It drives me crazy when I see people put succulents in here. Uh-huh. They're not going to live. Yeah. They're going to die very fast. And so that's where an open terrarium comes in. If you like open terrariums, your best bet to plant those are going to be succulents. Okay, they don't need a lot of water. They can tolerate the arid environment of an open terrarium. Succulents will not work in a closed terrarium. Okay, Christmas cactus, on the other hand, that works lovely. Like, how many of you take cuttings off of Christmas cactus and stick it in? Yeah, my grandmother does that, and she always gives me some, and I was like, well, this is really cool. It's a small cutting. I'm going to see. I had one terrarium that every single plant in it died except the Christmas cactus, and it lived for like 1.5 years. Perfectly happy until I replanted it. So those work really well in terrariums, especially if you take a small cutting. You want to select plants that are somewhat slow growing, because our goal is to not to have to open this and take care of it. Our goal is to get it where we want it to be, shut the lid, and then just use it for observation and to watch what happens. But we don't want to have to open it continually and cut plant material out, because that's going to mess up our water cycle in here. You do have to do it some, but you just don't want to be doing it too often. The plants also need to be able to tolerate low to medium light levels, because you cannot take this jar and set it on a windowsill and open the blinds to give it sun. Because if you do, you're going to cook your plants. This is going to heat up, and all those plants are going to get too hot, and they will die. This has to be set in an area where it has indirect sunlight. So if you have a kitchen window over your sink, you don't want to sit it on that windowsill. You're going to want to sit it over to the side where it's still getting indirect sunlight to support those plants, but not direct sun. So that's why those plants have to be able to tolerate low to medium light levels, because we do not want to put them in direct sun. Now, somebody I gave a Christmas ornament to, they hung it on their windowsill. I got to watch it in the process of burning. Yes, ma'am.
Can they do well under artificial light, like in an office with this type of lighting?
They will do well for a while. If you start seeing them get leggy and kind of the color starts to fade on them, then you need to just give them, you need to move them and give them a little bit of extra light. Also in that situation, I will say, we generally don't fertilize, but if you start to see a problem, then you can add a little bit of liquid fertilizer and let them have just a little bit to help get them back healthy. But probably a quarter of the recommended rate, and just give them a little bit of fertilizer. Great question. Let's see. Oh, so size of plants. This comes into play a little bit. If you go to some garden centers, you can get lucky enough to find some plants in this size container. These are really, really hard to find, though. Again, these I found at Durham Garden Center. Medvin Shrubbery maybe has some.
That's not the Kester thing.
Okay, yeah. So the only place I've been able to find close is Durham Garden Center. Yes, ma'am?
The nursery or garden center out from Gibsonville.
A plants.
Yeah, they sell plants for fairy gardens, and they have miniature plants.
Okay, and it's called A&A Plants?
Yeah, I think so.
In Southern States. Okay, yeah. See, I've only been here a year. I'm still learning.
It's off of 61. You have to go way out.
Okay.
It's in
Brown Summit.
Okay, Brown Summit, yeah.
I will drive far to find little plants. It's in Durham. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to be smart. I promise. Like I don't know the area that well yet. I know it's across the street from a Food Lion, and I think it's off the Hillsboro Road.
Just Google it.
Yeah, I think it's off the Hillsboro Road, but I'm not sure. It's not far off the. It's not far off of 85.
Oh,
okay. Yeah. Yes.
It's 4586 Hillsboro Road in Durham.
4586 Hillsboro Road.
I think 4530 tiny plants. And also every now and then Aldi will have bring in. I mean it's if you catch it.
Okay. So this little guy did come from Durham Garden Center and he'll work great. But also if you do go to places like Lowe's, and sometimes you can find some really cool house plants at Walmart of all places, you can be really lucky. And I bought this 4-inch pot at Lowe's, but I can get, sorry Chris, I'm probably gonna make a mess on the floor on accident. You can get one. Awesome.
We have one.
Two. Let's see. Three. Four. Five. I just got 5 plants out of 1 4-inch pot that I paid like maybe $2 for. So, because our terrariums are small most of the time, so we can't fit that whole 4-inch pot in, but what we can do is we can give it a little bit of a root haircut. Oh, that actually makes it happy. It'll send out more roots, yeah. When you injure a root, if you sever it, it's gonna send out more right behind it, yeah. This will be fine. Plus, let's think about it. When we propagate a plant, what kind of environment are we putting it in? A humid, warm environment to help support it. This is essentially a little propagation chamber right here for us. So you can, I also love to buy croton at Lowe's. But the problem is, I can get a lot of plants out of this. There's 3 in there, because most croton plants, that's how they grow them. So I'll cut their roots a little bit, bring them up. There. Oh my goodness, he was happy. But he's not gonna fit in my terrarium.
Yeah.
He's
no.
Put
the top off.
Yep.
No.
Now he will. So I normally remove the lower leaves just a little bit because they may drop anyways, and that's just kind of adding a little bit of extra room for stuff to start to feed on to grow. cut him one more time. So I took a giant plant that could fit. If you have a big terrarium, they can fit. If you have a little one, so all he'll start sending out more growth. He's going to be fine. You will have to prune this plant more than some of the other ones. But look how cute he is. So now you can stick your finger in and you're going to feel the rock. Do not dig down into the rock with your finger. Stop as soon as you hit it. You just want to move the soil out of the way.
Take the charcoal.
The charcoal, that's fine. It won't hurt the charcoal. You probably won't even be able to feel that charcoal in there. So now he's got him a little root system. I'm going to put him down in there. Now he's not got a whole lot of soil. So again, I'm just going to gently push on him to support him and pop his little leaves down in there. He'll fit. All right, now see what I mean? It's nice to be able to cram two hands down in there. Okay, so look, I got one plant. Yay! Okay, so one plant in, and then again, almost every 4-inch pot that I have over here from Lowe's, actually every pot that I have from Lowe's, we will divide. So you guys can fit about, you don't want to overcrowd the terrarium, but you do, because you want to leave room for the plants to grow slightly. So I would recommend putting about 2 to 3 plants per one of these size terrariums. And then if you have moss that you get out of your yard, you know, save a little room for moss. And then you'll add the plant, and then we will. So I'm going to go ahead and put my other plants in here, and then we'll talk about the next step. So I'll make another little hole in here. Again, I'm not digging my fingers down into those rocks. I'm just moving the soil to the side a little bit. Got my plant in there. His root system's a little bigger. If that happens, there's nothing wrong. If you're like, well, I can't get it to fit because I don't have enough soil, there's nothing wrong. Add a little bit of soil, knock it off of him or her, and then just add it in around and then push down just a little bit. And then I think I want to use this little fern too. And I should be able to divide it as well. So just a little bit of a different color. So you can really make these really pretty with all the nice colors we have now. Okay, so now we've added our plants. The next step is to add water. This is a very critical step. Plants need water to live, right? How many of you have killed a plant from giving it too much water?
Yeah.
I have. I've also killed them for not giving them enough. You know, it happens. It's a very fine line. So squirt bottles work really well to get water in. If you don't have a squirt bottle, I have 2 small children and all their medicine comes with like little syringes. Those work really well. Tablespoons, just filling up tablespoons, or the turkey baster type things. You can put a little bit of water in there. The goal is if you got soil on the plant, one, go ahead and try and wash that off with the squirt bottle. Clean them up. You do not want to add, if you got it on the side, try to wash that off. You don't want to add too much water because we're closing the lid on it. There's nowhere for that excess water to go, and it can lead to rotting. It takes up too much of the plant doesn't have enough oxygen in the soil. It'll start the process of rotting, and that's not what we want. If you start to realize that you have too much water, as in your terrarium is staying condensated all the time, it's really heavy condensation, all you have to do is take the lid off. Let it sit for a day, 2, maybe a week. Keep a check on it. Don't let it dry out. It'll dry out really quickly that way. And then once you're like, well, let me see how the condensation looks the next day, then go ahead and put the lid back on. You want to look at the condensation. It usually happens in the morning. You want to look at it, and if there is condensation on the jar, that's the indication that you're good. Even condensation. If there is a lot, it's so heavy you can barely see the plants, you got too much. If there's no condensation, you might not have enough. But with that, I would give it another day or 2 and wait and see. If your soil looks wet but you're not seeing condensation, I would not add more water. I would let it hang out for just a little bit. So my general rule of thumb when I'm adding water is I want to be able to see it start to run down the sides of the substrate into my rocks down below. And I'm not seeing that just yet. And sometimes when you go buy a bag of soil or potting soil, it's been sitting outside and it's been getting rained on. So sometimes it's already pretty wet and you might not have to add a whole lot of water at all.
I was going to ask that. You put dry soil in there. You didn't moisten it at all, did you?
No. I did not.
And almost all the potting soil you buy is wet. It's so, you know,
yeah.
That's the fertilizer. So
yeah, and if it's hydrophobic, which means you can tell that it's been dry for a while, and you think it's not going to wet up, go throw it in the compost pile. Don't use it because it won't work very well. These bags have holes in them, and they always. I mean, this bag's been piled up with several other like it on my back deck all summer long in the shade. It gets some sun, some shade, but it's been plenty wet for it. So, okay. So I've got the water added. Oh yeah, you can start to see the channels of water going down to the rock. So you know that you're getting that water to start moving into your substrate, which is what you want it to do, because that's where your roots are. So the roots can now start taking up some water. Now, what's going to cause the condensation to start to appear on the glass?
Warmth,
freezing
sun, of the plants.
The breathing of the plants. Somebody said it. Transpiration. Was that you, Chris? Okay, I couldn't pick out your voice. Yeah, so the transpiration. That's so cool. You can see the plant transpiring in here. You get to see its product. All right, got water now. Oh, I forgot to talk about these little guys. So some people really like to add figurines to their terrariums. Now, I don't really understand why three very small squirrels cost $9. But they do. And they're really cute. So, like, for example, one of my previous supervisors really loved owls. And so I had made her a terrarium years ago, and it had gotten kind of overgrown. It needed to be replaced. And so for her birthday, I took her terrarium home, and I redid it. And then when it reappeared, I had just added this little owl figurine in it, and she loved it. It was awesome for her. And so, you know, if you're trying to make that special gift for someone, and they have something they like, go ahead and just pop some of these in there. That it kind of creates this really nice little added feature. Especially if you're doing it, I need my grabber, my flex grabber or whatever it's called. If you're doing this for kids, it kind of brings it to life for them, right? It gives them these little creatures. So again, I got these little squirrels from somewhere, some store. I'm adding them.
You can probably get them at the dollar store. They have a lot of little fun
stuff. Yeah. That's where I've got
nine. I need to look at
the Dollar Tree.
I got this from Target in the dollar section. I just happened to walk past one day. Now, the only bad thing about him is he's a little top heavy. And so if you put it in and you move your terrarium, it's going to fall over. But then if you just stick your hand back in and set it up. So again, there's these just some stuff you walk by, you're going to see and think, hey, that would look really cool in a terrarium. And it really just adds an extra life to the terrarium. Okay, we've got our figurines. Go over our checklist on our sheet. We've got our figurines, which are optional. We've got our water. That is not optional. We have our plants. I guess those could be optional. We have our substrate, our charcoal, our rockery, and our glass container. And we're making a closed terrarium. There it is. So my advice to you is if you want to make these as a gift to give to someone, make it ahead of time. It doesn't always work for me because sometimes I run out of time. But make it ahead of time. Sit it in direct sunlight somewhere and monitor it to make sure you've got the water. Because if you're giving it to someone who doesn't know that much about plants, if it dies on them, they're not going to be happy with that. It's not going to make them excited about plants. But you know what to look for. So make sure that you're getting that right condensation in there. And then after you've monitored it for a week or so, and you're like, okay, this terrarium's good. My plants have gotten established. It's ready. Then give it to them. Because you don't want to give them something that's going to fail. That doesn't make anybody happy. Okay, so just the general care that's on the bottom of your sheet. So, and I'll put that on there. Manage carefully for the first few weeks if you're giving it as a gift. If it's for you too, keep an eye on it because it may start to show that it has too much moisture, or it may show that it doesn't have enough. Do not place in direct sunlight. We just talked about that. We generally do not want to add fertilizer unless we absolutely have to. And then if we do, we're adding a very, very small rate. Occasionally you will have to prune, right? You just saw how big that croton was. That's how it grows. If you don't want to have to prune something, then you're going to need to pick plants that stay low growing. It is really cool for some of the plants that we use in here that grow up, like this one. Sometimes they'll just start, it's so humid, they just start growing roots from their nodes where leaves are, and it is really quite fascinating to watch. You rarely have to water this. If you start to see it drying out and your soil has gotten dry, or you're not seeing that condensation appear, then you may need to open it up and give it a few more drops of water through a squirt bottle or a teaspoon or whatever works for you. If you start to see plants that are dying, take them out as soon as you can. Now, if they just have a leaf that's starting to die, that's fine. Pull that leaf off gently, the plant's fine. But if you start to see that whole plant actually rotting, go ahead and take it out because it's just going to lead to some other, your other plants. It increases the chance for those other plants to rot as well. And then lastly, the list on the back of your sheet, these are some of the plants that I have used personally that work well for me. And so I'd just like to provide that to people in case you're going to look for stuff and you're not exactly sure how it's going to work. These I've used. They work great. Try new stuff, though. Creeping Jenny, I've been wanting to try that. I don't know if that would work in a terrarium, but how bright and green and yellow it is, that would be really cool. So just think outside the box for stuff like the sundew. I wish I could find another little tiny sundew like that. I might have it in lots of terrariums. But so just think outside the box and test stuff out. You know how to make them now. So if one fails for you, you know how to redo it. It's kind of a nice process to get to test it out and also see the plants live. So, all right, so that's all I have to say. I'll open it up for questions. And then once we finish questions, we'll all kind of work as a team to divide the plants up and pick out the plants we need and get your terrariums up in working order. Sound good? Yes, ma'am.
I was just wondering, are you supposed to remove the decaying plant materials because it adds to like the compost and heat element?
Because there are sometimes there may be some type of bacteria in there that will start to grow on those decaying. They're starting to break them down, but you don't want them to grow and to start messing with other plants as well. Yeah, good question. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, if somebody wants some creeping Jenny, you know that lots of creeping Jenny. It's growing in my yard and it's in my lots and it's really pretty and it's growing in the sides and all that. But all you got to do is just pull up a little bit and then you got it, you know.
And so, I don't know how it'll do in a terrarium, so if you guys do it, I need a report back on how, if it lives. Yes, ma'am.
What about temperature? Like, we're going to change now and go into when it's drier in your house.
Yes.
During winter and heat, what's like the optimal range?
Generally speaking, whatever your house is set at, this will be fine. Because your house isn't going to get to a freezing temperature. And it's not going to get to a, right, because it's room temperature. It's what we're comfortable at. Even if you set your house down at like 60, this will be fine. If you set your house at 75, this will be fine. The beauty of this, if you don't put it in direct sunlight, the plants are going to have moisture in here, so even if there's heat blowing in the house, there's no way for it to dry out because it's sealed. Okay, so we should be, it should be fine. Yeah.
I've got moss and extra plants over here to share.
Oh, that's great. Okay, perfect. Yes, ma'am.
I had a question. When you were talking about the condensation, and I just wrote down light is good, and not good, none, not good either. So we're to expect condensation.
On the glass.
On the glass itself. Mm-hmm. And having it at all times is a good thing.
I would say towards the end of the day, it should be less than it was at the morning. If okay. It's still really, and that's not, it depends too on the sunlight, on the light levels, and how the plants are transpiring and stuff. But if you have really heavy condensation all day, then that's a problem. If you have just a little bit of heavy condensation in the morning and then it starts to drop off, that's okay. Because you really won't see condensation all day long. It kind of follows a cycle. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Good question. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Is it okay just to use regular tap water?
Yes, ma'am. You can use regular tap water. That's fine. Mm-hmm. Good questions. Any other ones?
I think we might cover up these tables here and do the division up on the...
Yes, that's a great idea, Chris. Okay, so you guys can start. We've got the materials. We've got Permatil. We've got one other type of rock that you can use. The charcoal is here for us, and we've got soil, and then Chris and I will put the plants up here on this table and go ahead and start dividing those so you can come by and grab them.